we go on a Monday. It is great to be back live in Los Angeles. It's the Herd, wherever you may be and however you may be listening. Thanks for making us part of your day. 1 hour from now, where Colin was right, where Colin was wrong. As always, a bounty, plenty of both. J-Mac, you watched a lot of college hoops over the weekend, I imagine. I watched a lot of NFL free agency over the weekend, all fired up on that.
Oh, really?
We're going to have the dynasty. I finally finished the dynasty on the Patriots. So Scott Pioli and Jeff Benedict, who wrote the book, that's coming up today. That's fast. One of my favorite documentaries of all time. I'm not sure if it rises to MJ, but in terms of football dynasties, top of my head, best football dynasty I've ever seen.
Wow. I mean, a lot of NFL news today, college basketball, and I survived the move. We are alive. I am present.
Shocking. Your wife controlled it. You're all good. So, I'm sitting there watching TV over the weekend. Went in a little respite, little break, right? And I'm watching it. There's a lot of college basketball. And there's also a lot of hype and hope and optimism for the NFL season. We got the draft about a month away. And it's a big quarterback draft. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, one of the reasons I love the NFL draft, especially at quarterbacks, is there's a randomness to it. Who can figure out the quarterback? Some are tall, some are short, some move, some don't. Some ad libs, some not so good. Why do so few quarterbacks, five or six first-round quarterbacks, sometimes one hits, five massively fail? And I've always been fascinated in any business finding the common thread. What doesn't interest me as much as why? Why does it happen? And so take the 2020 draft. First two rounds, they all hit. Burrow's great. Tua's gotten Pro Bowl votes. Justin Herbert, excellent. Jordan Love, looks like he's going to be a guy. Jalen Hurts got to a Super Bowl. They all hit at some level. And that was not considered, after Burrow, a great quarterback draft. People had real questions about Tua's health and Herbert's kind of mechanics. Jordan Love was considered a total project. And Jalen Hurts, I was one of them. Is he a starter in the NFL? Then you go to the 2021 draft, and that was nothing but hype and optimism, and they've all bombed except Trevor Lawrence. Zach Wilson, whiff. Trey Lance, miss. Justin Fields, backup. Mac Jones, not working. Kyle Trask, not playing. And Trevor Lawrence, I like him. He was the one I said is going to work. He has worked to some degree. He's got a playoff win. But there is a randomness to it, and I'm fascinated with the why. There's a Rubik's Cube randomness to it. Remember in high school when I was in high school when the Rubik's Cube comes out, or roughly there, high school, college. And there was always one kid that figured it out. He could do it repeatedly over and over in like 3 minutes. He wasn't the smartest kid you knew. He wasn't the best student. He was kind of an oddball, but he figured out the Rubik's Cube. And in the NFL, in this randomness to find the right quarterback, the one kid is the Packers. They ace it quickly. They got Favre, they got Rodgers, they got Jordan Love. So they're that kid. But it's so random that organizations that we don't historically trust are also great at it. The Cincinnati Bengals. Go back to Kenny Anderson. I know I'm old and have gray hair. Kenny Anderson was outstanding. And then Boomer Esiason won an MVP. And then Carson Palmer was great. And then it was, Andy Dalton made multiple playoffs. And Joe Burrow. The Bengals are great at it? Yeah, they are. I mean, there's been a few misses, but they've hit on more than the Steelers have. And how about the Chargers? John Hadle, look him up. Dan Fouts, Drew Brees, Philip Rivers, Justin Herbert. The Chargers? We don't trust the Chargers. They're great at quarterbacks. The Bengals are great at quarterbacks. The Packers have hit three straight. It's a cautionary tale about this draft because I'm sitting there looking at all these quarterbacks, and this draft class reminds me a lot of the 2021 draft class where you got about five, six first-rounders, all of them getting hype, and there's one transcendent quarterback, Caleb Williams, just like Trevor Lawrence. Caleb Williams can't miss, but Trevor went to a weird, odd losing franchise. Jacksonville, and it's been bumpy. And here goes Caleb Williams. He's going to another franchise that can't get the quarterback right, the Chicago Bears. And so I looked at this draft with Bo Nix and Michael Penix and J.J. McCarthy and Jaden Daniels and Drake May and Caleb Williams. And you know the thing that scares me and makes me think about the 2021 draft? Go look at the 2021 quarterbacks. A lot of them went to defensive coaches, defensive cultures, and teams with more good defensive players. Yeah, that's where Mac Jones went. Justin Fields, Zach Wilson. At the time, Trevor Lawrence. They had to go buy offensive players his second year in the league. And so I look at this class, and who are the first three teams drafting? Chicago, Washington, New England. Defensive coach, defensive coach, defensive coach, all working with an offensive coordinator they've never worked with before. You think that's ideal? That's why I have said, and I'll say it again, that the two quarterbacks in this class of the six or seven that could get drafted in the first two rounds, the two quarterbacks my instincts tell me will work. I think Caleb Williams, like Trevor Lawrence, is talented enough to just figure out ways to be productive and win some games. He'll probably be on his second coach by Thanksgiving or a second year, but I think he's talented enough. And the other quarterback that'll work is whoever goes to Minnesota. Love their offensive coach, Pro Bowl left tackle, superstar receiver, excellent running back Aaron Jones, excellent tight end, excellent number two receiver Jordan Addison, and overall a top 12 offensive line. That is a perfect place for a J.J. McCarthy, a Michael Penix, Bo Nix. So I don't have a second quarterback that's going to work. It's Caleb Williams and whoever goes to Minnesota. If you put Patrick Mahomes today, from the Chiefs, you put him on the Vikings. With those offensive pieces, that coach, stability and ownership, I would say the Vikings get to the Super Bowl. That's how highly I think of Minnesota's offensive talent. Because I do believe outside of the occasional Andrew Luck, Trevor Lawrence, and Caleb Williams, it's mostly where you land. We make so much hype about J.J. McCarthy. I don't love him. Many do. If J.J. McCarthy goes to Minnesota, and by the way, did you see what Minnesota did over the last 3 days? They accumulated a second first-round pick. So the Vikings have two first-round picks for one reason. To move up, potentially, to get a quarterback they view as the guy. Somebody could be Drake May. They could move up to three. It could be J.J. McCarthy. They may have to move up to seven or eight. But I thought the Vikings were the interesting team. They accumulate a second first-round pick. My guess is they're doing that because they may have to use it to get their quarterback. And that kid who can sit behind Sam Darnold for 1 year, maybe just until Thanksgiving, will have the second highest shot to succeed. For years and years, I tried to predict who was going to work. And by and large, next year's draft, by the way, does not have a Caleb Williams, Andrew Luck, or a Trevor Lawrence. It'll come down again to who gets the offensive coach, who gets the best offensive line, who gets the weapons, because what's happening in football now, it's so popular, there's so much money. By Thanksgiving of your second year, even if you're talented, people have emotionally in the building moved on. All you can hope for is a quarterback, the owner likes you, Daniel Jones, and wants to resign you. All right. So I watched, we'll have a couple of guests on today to talk about it. I like documentaries. I watch very few movies. I watch 100 docs a year. I watched six this weekend. I like watching docs. There's not a lot of great sports documentaries. And I thought Dynasty was excellent. Now, some people, it's looking back at the 20 years, 10 parts of the Patriots dynasty. So, I mean, obviously, you could do 30 parts of this thing. They took the Aaron Hernandez, Deflategate, the Malcolm Butler Super Bowl, the squabbles, Tom and Belichick at the end. They took the most dramatic stuff. Same with MJ and the Bulls. They're not going to talk about a Tuesday game against Orlando in a documentary. You're going to talk about Rodman in Vegas, Jerry Krause and Michael not getting along, the punch. That's what you're going to talk about in a documentary.